So, shall we begin?
Yes, madam. Welcome again for
Thank
this
you, Dr. Shishir.
our series of mythology lectures.
Yes,
Yeah.
thank you so much.
So
Thank you
we will
for,
continue, madam.
thank you
Please
for inviting
start,
me.
madam.
Yeah, thank you. So, good afternoon, everybody. Today we'll be talking of about pancytopenia in a child. What you do when you see a child with pancytopenia. So, we will begin with defining pancytopenia. We will delve into what are the causes of pancytopenia, and then we'll do a series of cases so that different cases will help us to understand how do we approach a child. Of course, as usual, this is my center, so I always like to show it once in the talk. So, what do we mean by pancytopenia? I'm sure all of you are aware. When we say pan, it means all. Cytopenia means cell lines. So, penia means reduction. So, when there is a decrease in all three cell lines, it is called pancytopenia. We call it bicytopenia when two cell lines are reduced. When single cell line is reduced, we either address it as anemia, leukopenia, or thrombocytopenia. Now, pancytopenia actually is not a diagnosis, it is a finding on investigation. So, one must understand that you don't make a diagnosis clinically that this child is suffering from pancytopenia. After you see the CBC and you say, oh, all three cell lines are depleted, that means this child has pancytopenia. Conventionally, in children, older children, infancy and above, maybe late infancy, I would talk of, not neonatal would be very different. Them, a hemoglobin of less than 11 gram percent, total count of less than 4,000, with an ANC less than 1,000, platelets less than 100,000 per cubic millimeter. These are the parameters that tell us that the child has pancytopenia. Now, one must always, when you get a report, we have already discussed in ABC or CBC, that don't take every report for granted. Verify whether this is true report. In the sense that pre-collection error or other pre-analytical errors should also be kept in mind, such as how was the blood collected? Was it collected correctly? Was there enough anticoagulant in the bulb that you used? So, clotted samples can give you pancytopenia, which is not true. And of course, sometimes the counter can give errors where actually there are no cytopenias, but because of some microclots or some errors in the computation, you may get a wrong report. So, always verify it if you are not sure because patient is clinically not fitting into it. Now, is all aplastic anemia equal to pancytopenias? Because when we talk of pancytopenia, we assume this has to be aplastic anemia. The answer is no. There are many conditions which will come with pancytopenias. Aplastic anemia happens to be one of them. So, I will just look at these causes with you. So, when you have impaired production, it can lead to cytopenias. Peripheral destruction can lead to cytopenias. Impaired production and peripheral destruction together can lead to cytopenias. What are the broad categories in impaired production? Aplastic anemia obviously is one of the main causes of pancytopenia due to impaired production, both the congenital variant and the acquired. Bone marrow infiltrating disorders like malignancies, autoimmune myelofibrosis, granulomatous disorder, anything that is occupying the marrow, not allowing the normal hematopoiesis to continue, will lead to pancytopenia. Nutritional deficiencies, we are very much aware of megaloblastic anemias where vitamin B12, folate both can be low and cause pancytopenia and myelodysplastic syndromes. Whereas in peripheral destruction, mainly you have two causes, autoimmune hemolytic pancytopenia or a splenic sequestration. So very large spleen sometimes can lead to mild pancytopenia. Generally, a severe pancytopenia should not be attributed to a spleen, because you don't see significant clinically relevant pancytopenia with a splenic enlargement. You may see anemia, which is recurrent in a patient who is already transfusion dependent. He may require more number of transfusions, more frequent transfusions, more amount of transfusion. That can be explained by the splenic sequestration, but not the significant leukopenia or thrombocytopenia. And PNH is another cause of impaired production and peripheral destruction both together. And of course, you have various other conditions where you can have both SLE, drugs, leukemia, hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis, and transfusion-associated graft versus host disease, plus some infections. You are in the picture. Listen, you are in the video. Because I'm sitting here. Sorry, I have to tell my husband. Okay, so then you have the cellularity of the marrow deciding what could be the conditions which are leading to pancytopenia. So one, we saw just now various causes based on the pathophysiology as far as production and peripheral destruction is concerned. The other way to classify them is based on the finding of the bone marrow. So if the bone marrow is hypocellular, so to say, then you know that all the conditions where actually there is an aplasia, like acquired aplastic anemia or inherited bone marrow failure syndromes, which include a number of conditions which I will allude to later, PNH, hypoplastic myelodysplasia, or virus-associated aplastic anemia, which is probably sometimes transient, and therefore we do not necessarily classify it into acquired aplastic anemia. Cellular marrows, you have primary bone marrow disease where marrow is producing ineffectively. So myelodysplasia and PNH can be both hypoplastic as well as cellular. Secondary to any systemic diseases where actually there is marrow proliferation happening, but there are wrong type of cells like in storage disorder occupying the marrow, therefore not allowing the hematopoiesis to go on. SLE can lead to suppression of marrow by sort of infiltrating, and hypersplenism, as we said, peripheral destruction. SLE also has significant peripheral destruction, antibody mediated, but also it can suppress the marrow from forming cells which are significantly high in number. Vitamin B12 folate deficiency can lead to ineffective erythropoiesis. So therefore, there is a marrow hyperproliferation, but they are not effectively thrown out into the circulation. Infections, storage disease, I already said. Infiltrative marrow disorders like leukemias, like HLH, like any metastasis of solid tumors, osteopetrosis, myelofibrosis, which occupy the marrow space and therefore do not allow the marrow hematopoiesis to happen. So these are various conditions where you will have pancytopenia. So now we'll go to some cases one by one. And while we are discussing cases, I will also discuss a little bit of the theoretical background for that condition. Now this boy, a 13-year-old, 9-month-old, Hindu community, Jain, therefore strict vegetarian, I'm giving you a hint, was referred to us for dropping hemoglobin from 11.4 to 6.5 gram per cent with loss of weight for 8 months. He had repeated episodes of giddiness or dizziness for 3 days. There's no significant past or family history, no pica, worm, blood and stools, bleeding from any other site. He was a pure vegetarian. On examination, he was pale, had knuckle hyperpigmentation, liver was not palpable, spleen was 3 centimeters firm. So obviously the diagnosis that we would make in such a patient with pallor and knuckle hyperpigmentation, who's a vegetarian, strict vegetarian, would be a nutritional megaloblastic anemia. So here you see the hemoglobin is 6.1 with low RBC count with a very high MCV, as you can see, 113 MCV. And what is the RDW? We have a RDW of 18.2. You can see there is a wide RDW because there are macrocytes seen in the red cells. Your white cells are 3.33. That means 3,330. Again, 4,000 is the cutoff, as I already showed you also in the definition and even in the counter. Then you have platelets of 1.75, but they are not low, but still they are on the lower side for this child. Now, therefore, we consider this as something similar to a pancytopenia. If you look at the smear in this child, he has nice chromia, that means normochromic or hyperchromic cells. That means the hemoglobinization of the cells is good enough. But see the large cells, macroovalocytes here too, and macrocytes. And you have hypersegmented neutrophil with 6 lobes nucleus in this polymorph. And you have, of course, some changes of poikilocytosis and some small cells also, because by and large nutritional anemias will be dimorphic in nature in any patient. Then if you look at further findings in the smear, he had basophilic stippling, this actual smear of the child. Here you can see the enlarged version and Cabot ring. So these were the findings. Cabot ring is because of ineffective erythropoiesis, that the RNA is not thrown out. Same way basophilic stippling, because ribosomes are left behind. And what was the folate level? Folate was 1.89, which was quite okay. It was not very low, but RBC folate was on the lower side, which is, now there is a controversy whether you should look at RBC folate or serum folate, but the final conclusion is that either of them is okay, and by and large serum folate is good enough because it's easy to test, whereas RBC folate is difficult to test. And here therefore you see they have written it is calculated from the serum folate. So in fact, you should not ask for RBC folate. You can go by serum folate. Look at his LDH. It was sky high, 1600. And look at the vitamin B12. Very low, 98 picograms per ml. So this was typically a megaloblastic anemia. And we treated him as usual with vitamin B12 injections. You can use oral, but it will take longer for the patient to improve. Also, sometimes in chronic vitamin B12 deficiency or dimorphic anemias, the intestinal villi are denuded and atrophied. And therefore, if you give orally, the absorption may not be very effective, and which then leads to a feeling that this child is not responding. So it is always safer to initially start with injectable. Once you have given injectable for some time, maybe a month, then you can shift to oral. As I will show you in this child, we did that. Now, I have said we must give an initial dose of 0.2 micrograms per kilo for 2 days or 10 micrograms for 2 days subcutaneously. If you calculate 0.2 for a child who's say 10 kg or even 20 kg, it will come very low and it will be very difficult to calculate or rather have that volume correctly put in a syringe. So we decided to change it to 10 micrograms for 2 days, because 10 micrograms is still measurable. Because as you know, 1 ml contains 500 micrograms. So you have to use a TT syringe when you are giving 10 micrograms. So you give this for 2 days subcutaneously because it's a very small dose. Why do you do this? Because when you give B12, the red cell production increases suddenly. When the red cell mass starts increasing, the potassium from the extracellular compartment is used up for the intracellular potassium in the RBCs. And when the shift happens suddenly, then there is a phenomenal drop in the potassium and patient can come with a hypokalemic paralysis or a problem of hypokalemia with cardiac issues. So to prevent hypokalemia, in children especially, this is known because children are much more sensitive to a shift in potassium, which may be minor. Then you give 1000 micrograms per day for 7 days intramuscularly daily, and then followed by 100 micrograms per week for 3 to 4 weeks intramuscularly, followed by oral 5 to 10 micrograms per day if dietary deficiency is persisting. If we can correct, which is very difficult in a vegetarian, you may have to give fortified foods which contain B12, that may take care of supplementing the daily requirement. If pernicious anemia is diagnosed in a child, then you have to continue 1000 micrograms intramuscularly 6 monthly. There are some sublingual preparations available and can be used instead of injectable, but again, there is a query whether it is as effective as injectable. There is also reports of inhalational B12 available, but I will allude to that a little later. Now, if you look at his reports later, this is after 1 month, and you see the hemoglobin has risen to 13.3. You remember what was the hemoglobin when we first saw this child? It was 6.1. Okay, and this was on 1st September 2017. And we'll go to this report now, which we have, repeat. And you see it is 13.3 on 1710 and within 6 weeks. And even the white cells have come up and the platelets have come up. So classically, and you see the RDW, it has gone back to normal. So 6 weeks and the patient is perfectly fine just with giving vitamin B12. This is a little later again, after about another 2 weeks, and you can see it has further risen to 14.6. The RDW has further gone down to 12.9. White cells have stabilized and platelets have stabilized. So perfect patient for treating, because they get better and then they leave you and you feel happy that this child is now doing well. Now, I was talking of the inhalational therapy in Pernicious anemia. Way back in 1953, some person, Smith, he actually gave to three patients inhalational therapy, and in two of them had severe manifestation and one had mild manifestation of pernicious anemia, because they didn't want to take injections and they found good result, okay, in adequate clinical and hematologic responses. But there is a, you know, refute by another person, Shinton et al., in 1967, that vitamin B12, when given inhalationally, it may be effective, though it is not regarded superior to that of injections, but the possibility of inducing pulmonary damage can be there. And therefore, you should not use inhalational. Though again, in 2018-19, there is news of availability of vitamin B12 vapes, which is a vaporized form, which is actually used for marijuana and drugs. So it is actually dangerous because they might mix drugs and addict the people to using that. Therefore, one should avoid using inhalational. But I just thought it was a very interesting aspect which I came across. So I must share with you. Now, treatment of folate deficiency is simpler. You have to just use folic acid 5 milligrams daily in older children, in younger 1 to 2 milligrams daily. And this you give for 4 months period and they do well. Now, the point which we must not forget is when you are using vitamin B12 injectable, which I mentioned here, most of B12 preparations in the market are containing folate. So if you use both together, and if the deficiency of B12 is very severe and folate is supplemented along with B12, sometimes there will be a precipitation further of B12 deficiency in the neurologic tissue. This happens more commonly in adolescents and adults rather than in children, and that will precipitate the subacute combined degeneration at the spinal cord level and lead to problems with neurological. So you must avoid using folate before B12. And there is a preparation which is cyanocobalamin and there is a methylcobalamin. So methylcobalamin is a better preparation. It has lesser side effects and it is available purely as vitamin B12. Whereas cyanocobalamin, most of the preparations are with B1, B6, B12, folate B12 and B6. So keep in mind that. Now, coming to causes of megaloblastic anemia, I don't think we need to discuss this in detail because we all are aware that most commonly we see nutritional deficiency as the causes. There are inherited DNA synthesis disorders, inherited pyrimidine synthesis disorders, hereditary orotic aciduria, thiamine-dependent anemia. All those are known, but I don't think we see them in practice commonly. I have yet to diagnose a case of inherited disorder. Of course, methylmalonic acidemia with developmental delay is a known thing, and we have seen 2 cases in the past. But again, those are typical cases where you will not miss on the cause of the megaloblastic anemia. Oh, I think this I have repeated this slide. So how do we define megaloblastic anemia? It's a macrocytic anemia with generally leukopenia and thrombocytopenia, hyperplastic marrow with megaloblastosis affecting all 3 cell line progenitors, giant bands and metamyelocytes, which are not seen in leukemia and myelodysplasia, because ineffective erythropoiesis and some features may be similar in leukemia also and in MDS. So you have to differentiate. Is it common in children? Yes, it is pretty common. Since when? So in the last 35 years of my practice, initially when I began, we used to hardly see any megaloblastic anemia, especially B12 deficiency was not known. Folate was highly uncommon. What happened and what changed it? Suddenly we started seeing a spurt of megaloblastic anemias in children. This happened because the water pipeline was changed in Mumbai and new pipelines were laid down. Now, the previous pipelines were in proximity of the sanitation lines, and therefore there was contaminated water being sent to people. And because you were drinking contaminated water, we were getting B12 through that in the water. When it became cleaner water, we paid a price and we had to suffer megaloblastic anemia. But I think it's better to suffer megaloblastic anemia than to have unclean water to drink. So we have seen quite a few patients. We all know the sources, vitamin B12, milk, though it is a good source, it is not really drunk in the amount that you would need to drink to manage with only milk. Therefore, vegans are at risk from deficiency because they don't even drink milk. Recommended daily intake is very low, 0.1 microgram per day for infants, 1 microgram per day for adults, and 1.4 for pregnant and lactating women. Whereas folate recommended intake is 200 micrograms per day, and green leafy vegetables, any yellow vegetables, they all contain folate. Now let's go to the next case. It was a very interesting 8-year-old girl who came to us in 2014 when I was at Sion Hospital, and she had complaints of increasing pallor noticed since 1 month. And 6 months prior to that, she had generalized anasarca. She was investigated and diagnosed as nephrotic syndrome at that time, 6 months ago. Treated with steroids, started on 31st December for 3 months. So 31st December, she was started with steroids. 4th January, she was found to have anemia on CBC. This was the CBC, 4.4 gram hemoglobin. And this patient's CBC was reviewed only up till that level. I've masked the name and the doctor's name because of confidentiality. So this was left it at as it is. Nothing else was really looked at. I will come back to the CBC again because there is important aspects to discuss in this. They thought this is an iron deficiency anemia because that's the commonest cause of anemia. Now, what would we look at? We would look at MCV. We would look at many other things before labeling it as iron deficiency. But I don't think they looked at. Nevertheless, it's a lesson for all of us to learn. Iron studies were done, showed hardly any little increase in TIBC, little low iron, slight, not really bad because below 15% and below 12% we take as iron deficiency anemia. So it was not really low, but they considered it as iron deficiency. They started her on hematinics. They also did an HPLC. A2 was on the lower side, so it was not a thalpirate. And then oral hematinics were given within a month, 4 days. That is 4th January, they had done that CBC. And 8th February, it rose to 12.2 grams, the hemoglobin. This was unusual, but the parents were very happy and continued treatment with the nephrologist. 1 month prior to coming to us, she again had high-grade fever, that is in June. So started in December, January, she was having a CBC with anemia. She was given hematinics. February, she had a good hemoglobin. And again, in about April or so, she had high-grade fever. She took some treatment, did not improve. Went to another hospital for anemia and fever. And fever resolved, but child was not feeling well and was looking pale again. So she was then given packed red cells and referred for further workup, now this time by that pediatrician, to our hospital. So if we go back to that CBC, I would like all of you to pay attention. If that person who has seen this child has looked at hemoglobin and then looked at MCV, he wouldn't diagnose this as iron deficiency anemia for sure. It was 91. Anything above 90 is considered higher. Now look at the RDW. It's normal. RDW normal, high MCV should prompt you to think of marrow disease. Look at the white cell counts. 3,000. They are not 4,000 to 11,000. What about the platelets? Yes, they are more than 1.5, but they are on the lower side of normal for a healthy child. Now, the problem is on the peripheral smear, the pathologist has put hypomicroaniso and left it. And that prompted the pediatric nephrologist to start on hematinics, considering this as an iron deficiency anemia. But keep in mind these reports because MCV is high, RDW is normal. All cell lines are looking on the lower side. This is looking like a pancytopenia, and the reason why she has a pancytopenia has to be a bone marrow disease because the RDW is not wide. If it was wide RDW, I would think of a megaloblastic anemia as we saw in the previous case. So let's go back to this case. So she came to us in July. And if you see here in July, when she came to us on 4th July, her ANC is 918 with lymphocytic predominance, though the white cells are still 7,700, but her hemoglobin is 5.8 and platelets are 52,000. And if you see the first CBC, this is in our center, I think, the first CBC. It also shows a 9.1 gram hemoglobin because transfusion was given at 5.8 outside. Platelets again further down, and you see 912 ANC with 84% lymphocytic cells. Now, obviously, when lymphocytes are so high and everything else, as I told you, MCV was on the higher side in the beginning. This is all transfused RBCs, so you will not be able to make out. But obviously, here hematinics were given, here she was transfused, and here she was seen at our hospital, and there were blast cells seen. So very clearly, this was a leukemia to begin with, which responded to steroids dramatically. Steroids are blastolytic. They kill the blast in the marrow and they improve the patient. But single drug steroids, when it is used, it is like TB. You give only INH for a patient with TB, what will happen? Will develop a resistant TB. Similarly, this child now is a relapsed leukemia. So of course, these other tests were of no consequence. Iron studies were normal. And so these were the investigations at our center. As I told you, on 6th July, I'm not going into details. I already alluded to it. And she was diagnosed as leukemia. I've just put this report again to tell you that it could have been picked up right there. Nephrotic could have been a manifestation of leukemia infiltrating kidneys. So all nephrotics need not be primary. Her age was 8 years, 7 years, 8 years, which is again on the higher side. Full of blast on bone marrow, MPO negative suggesting an acute lymphoblastic leukemia. Immunophenotypic and typing and cytogenetic showed a pre-BALL. And here you can see blasts seen on the marrow. These are all blasts with nucleoli seen. And this was the impression that pre-B cell ALL. So the diagnosis de novo or relapsed, obviously. And risk stratification, she fits into high risk. And the protocol that one would start on her would be a high risk protocol. So she was given high risk icicle protocol, relapsed during fourth maintenance cycle again, was advised HSCT, sibling matched with her, parents and child were not willing for HSCT, and therefore she was given further chemotherapy. She completed treatment in April. She is presently in remission. These are her final reports where she still has a little bit of 11 gram hemoglobin. White cell count is low, still 1920, and platelets are normal. So she's recovering from the chemotherapy impact, but she's doing well. So messages from this case are, do not take anemia lightly. Nephrotic syndrome can be a manifestation of a systemic disease such as leukemia too. And once steroids are given, leukemia gets upstaged to high risk. So in ITPs also, we always warn, if you're giving steroids, please do a marrow to rule out leukemia. And outcomes can get compromised from 80 to 90% to 50 to 60% in such patients. So please be careful when dealing with such patients. This is a 14-year-old male child, came in April 2015 with complaints of fever, low to moderate, off and on for 4 months, anorexia and weight loss for 1 month, giddiness off and on, gum bleeds and petechia since 1 week, no bony swelling, pains or swellings, no Cox contact, known exposure to drugs, radiation, chemical agents, no history of jaundice, history of 6-pack red cells given outside, platelet transfusion given 11 times since April 2015. Vitals were stable. He was well-grown, pale child with petechia, ecchymosis and subconjunctival bleed. No retinal bleeds. Liver 2 cm, spleen not palpable. Systemic otherwise normal. This was a CBC, 4.2 gram hemoglobin with a platelet count of 11,000 with a white cell count of 2,900 only. And if you see, RDW is normal. This is by SD, so it is 49. And by CV, it should be 14 or so. So 15, you can see in the second one, 15. This is post-transfusion. He was a little better, but the CV is, RDW is 15. So obviously there's a pancytopenia with a normal RDW. What is the MCV? MCV is normocytic. So it could be a bone marrow involvement, and therefore a bone marrow is required. On peripheral smear, there were macrocytes, hypo, platelets reduced, retic count was low, ESR was high. A very high ESR, always you think of aplastic anemia as one of the conditions. Of course, there are other conditions like malignancies, like the collagen vascular disorders. Also, sometimes you can have a TB, which can have a three-digit ESR. So these are the conditions you would keep in mind. But with this MCV, which was normocytic, with a, of course, he has received transfusions in the past, so you cannot be sure whether this is true MCV. We should look at the first MCV before transfusion. With pancytopenia, with a normal RDW, it's more likely a marrow disease, especially if macrocytosis is present on the smear, if high ESR and retic is below 1%. Bone marrow aspirate biopsy confirmed aplastic anemia. This child, we worked up for Fanconi's. There were no abnormalities detected on ultrasound. The kidneys were normal, both sides. And we did a CMV as a pre-transplant workup, which was negative. We also looked at his parvovirus, which was positive, and we treated him for that. HBV DNA was negative, as you can see. Paro positive. HIV was negative. And of course, his HCV, HBsAg and HCV were also both non-reactive and negative. Cytogenetics showed chromosomal breakage, no indication of Fanconi's anemia. So he was not positive for chromosomal breakage, and there was no PNH. So we worked up thoroughly to rule out Fanconi's, to rule out PNH. And as we know that acquired aplastic anemia has multiple causes, so we have to rule out many of these causes before you consider the person for treating as aplastic, which cannot be treated by medications. Especially if it is a transient viral suppression, you can sometimes just treat, give supportive care, and they come around. So we rule out inherited, especially Fanconi's, because it's a commonest. Especially Fanconi's, because Fanconi's need not have always phenotypic manifestations which are classical in Fanconi's. They can be completely normal looking children. Normally you can have many manifestations, but these can be completely normal looking children yet could have Fanconi's. And why you should know before transplanting that it is Fanconi's or not. In Fanconi's, you cannot give the same conditioning drugs as you give for an acquired aplastic, because they are highly sensitive. They are a DNA repair syndrome, and therefore they're highly sensitive to certain drugs, and they can die due to conditioning. Therefore, rule out Fanconi's in every patient before referring for a hematopoietic stem cell transplant. So in this child, we had pancytopenia. We did a bone marrow aspirate and biopsy. We excluded Fanconi's. And of course, you should also exclude MDS if you are having some cells which are dysplastic. And then we looked at the peripheral blood also, which showed certain typical features of MCV on the higher side with RDW, which was normal. So acquired aplastic anemia was a diagnosis finally. Now, how do you choose between immunosuppressive therapy and bone marrow transplant? So we'll look at what are the various conditions that you, criteria you have to look at. One is you have to look at the severity of aplastic anemia. If the patient has non-severe aplastic anemia, you can manage with immunosuppression and with some supportive care, and they come around. But if they have severe or very severe, you will have to go for bone marrow transplant. Now, what is the criteria for severe aplastic anemia? In severe aplastic anemia, the bone marrow cellularity has to be below 25% or up below 50% with 30% residual hematopoietic cells. And this plus two of the following criteria: neutrophil count below 500, platelets below 20,000, absolute retic count below 20,000 per cubic millimeter. And very severe is as for severe, but the neutropenia which is below 200, profound neutropenia. And non-severe are those patients who do not fulfill criteria for severe or non-severe. So this is how you would classify And by that classification, this child was severe aplastic anemia. Now, what is the algorithm for managing idiopathic pediatric severe aplastic anemia? This is from the British guidelines, British Committee on Standards in Hematology. So establish the diagnosis, exclude inherited bone marrow failure syndrome. Nowadays, we do molecular tests. Earlier, we only did the chromosomal breakage. That was a 2014 patient. So we had not done molecular, but now we do molecular tests for every patient to rule out a inherited bone marrow failure syndrome before we take them up for any treatment. Tissue type, family and patient. That means do the HLA typing. If you have an HLA identical sibling, the first choice for this patient would be a matched sibling donor hematopoietic stem cell transplant. If you do not have an HLA identical sibling available, perform unrelated donor search through registries. If you have a 10 by 10 upfront matched unrelated donor, then go for the MUD transplant. But if you do not find, you can use immunosuppressive therapy with horse ATG. And if there is no response to this within 3 to 4 months, then you can proceed to a matched unrelated if by then it is available. If this fails and there is no MUD, then we proceed to third choice. What is the third choice? Mismatched unrelated donor HSCT. That is, even 9 by 10 match you can allow to be taken when there is no response to the ATG. So if no response to ATG and no matched unrelated or mismatched unrelated donor available, then proceed to fourth choice or to a clinical trial if available. Now fourth choice is second course of immunosuppressive therapy, which also can sometimes give good results up to 40%. Androgens, which will just be a palliation. Alemtuzumab has some good results, but very expensive treatment. Adding eltrompobac to IST or giving just simply eltrompobac has also given some good results. In fact, when you add eltrompobac to IST, the immunosuppressive therapy, you can have results as good as 90% in aplastic anemia. Haploidentical or unrelated donor, either umbilical cord stem cell transplant or basic hematopoietic stem cell transplant is the last choice. Now, I already told you, BMT is the first choice in if you have a matched donor. 60 to 70% is a long-term survival. In our own series, we have done 20 patients of aplastic anemia so far in 2 years, and 12 patients were acquired aplastic severe. And out of those 12, 8 were matched sibling who did well, and one matched related donors too. So 10 out of 12 are surviving and doing well. So it's a very good result. Whereas in inherited, we have 8 out of 15. So they are not doing so well. Now, immunomodulation can give to the tune of 40 to 50% in the long run, though it shows 75 to 85 in 5 year survival. But at 10 years odd, many patients relapse and they don't do well. There are many other immunosuppressive therapies used, but we're not discussing that in detail today because we are talking of approach. Of course, supportive care should be given carefully. Red cell transfusions when you're giving. First of all, once you diagnose an aplastic anemia, try to refer the patient as early as possible to a transplant center, because if you transfuse too much before you send them to us, they get alloimmunized. And with alloimmunization, it becomes difficult because the transplant outcomes become lesser because there will be a cross-reaction between the red cell antigens of the donor and the patient's antibodies. Secondly, when you give platelet transfusions repeatedly from various donors, you will cause refractoriness. And if you have refractoriness, you cannot take up the patient easily for transplant because he'll bleed during that time when he is having hardly any platelets formed. Now, therefore, preferably use filtered, unrelated donors, CMV negative, irradiated blood. And platelets also give irradiated, single unrelated donor preferable to avoid refractoriness. So single donor platelets are preferred. So this is the first patient whom we transplanted ever in our Sion Hospital when we started the BMT unit over there in 2014. He was a severe aplastic anemia, was transplanted on 25th August. And this was a donor, younger brother. And he had come to meet us at the Borivali Center after 2 years, 3 months. Now he is actually 5 years nearly 5 years post transplant and doing well. He actually sent me a new picture 3 days back, but I've not put that in the presentation. Okay, so this was a 12-year-old boy born of non-consanguineous marriage, fifth by birth order. Came in February with chief complaints of February 2015 with fever and blood in stools 7 days prior to coming to our hospital for which prior to I can't read that one minute to us for which he was admitted at another hospital. Sorry, excuse me. He had pancytopenia, was diagnosed as megaloblastic anemia, transfused packed red cells, received Witkofol injections in view of low serum B12. Bone marrow attempted outside was a dry tap and he was referred to us after a week in view of no improvement. So let's see what happened when we saw him. He was stable, pale, no bony tenderness, bleeds, hardly any lymph nodes, per abdomen, liver not palpable, spleen just palpable, no other systemic findings. And this was his serial CBCs, if you see, and the hemogram at our place. Sorry. If you see here, hemoglobin 5, white cell count is 2,100 and 39,000 platelets. And ANC here, you see, is very low. 261, 294, 448, 707, 420. So serially, it was low. So this was the patient's. And of course, marrow showed a hypocellular marrow, cellularity reduced, blast present, 80% blast. So this child was being treated as megaloblastic anemia because B12 was low. In fact, nobody has bothered to do a marrow in him because it was a dry tap, they left it. And if you see, this is a cytochemistry, myeloperoxidase was negative, so it was an ALL. Recursive B lineage, acute lymphoblastic leukemia. So you have this CD10, CD22 positive, HLA-DR positive, which is suggestive of B cell leukemia. So cytogenetics was unremarkable. There was a trisomy, so hyperdiploidy, which is actually a good sign. And final diagnosis was precursor B lineage ALL, standard risk. So every patient with pancytopenia need not be megaloblastic anemia or aplastic anemia. He can be a leukemia. That's the message from this case. Let's look at another case. This girl, 10-year-old, came with fever, loose motions, vomiting for 8 days, abdominal pain for 2 days, no history of jaundice, hematemesis or melena, no bleeding from any site, was referred for pallor and petechial rash to us. On examination, she was sick-looking child, febrile with tachycardia, tachypnea. Blood pressure was low, coated tongue, pallor present, icterus, petechiae, ecchymosis. So she was little hypotensive, tachycardic, tachypneic, and was febrile with pain in abdomen and had a coated tongue, was pale, was icteric mildly, and had bleeding. And tumid feel on abdomen with liver spleen palpable, as you can see in this. So, impression, I'm sure all of you as pediatricians would make a diagnosis of enteric fever in this child. We also consider enteric, but because we have these endemic infections, dengue, lepto, malaria, we also kept in mind those. On investigations, we did a CBC, PS, retic and ESR. So there was pancytopenia. Now, this is a beautiful part that you don't expect a pancytopenia in a patient with just acute infection, but here it was 5.4 gram hemoglobin, white cells 2,200 and a 16,000 platelet count. So once you have pancytopenia, you look at the MCV, it is high. RDW, normal. What does that suggest? A bone marrow disease. But there were hypersegmented neutrophils, which was misleading, because of which the patient can get diagnosed as megaloblastic anemia. But see the retic count, 0.8%, ESR 64, macrocytosis present, and lepto, dengue, both were negative. Vidal titer was high, clot culture, however, was negative. We do not go generally by a single Vidal titer. It should be paired sera, which should show a 4-fold rise in the titer. But this child looked clinically enteric and had no other positive things. So we treated with IV ceftriaxone. She responded to treatment and recovered her counts. And CBC after 10 days showed a good recovery. So this was a bone marrow suppression due to enteric, which is not so common, but we know that the salmonella resides in bone marrow. Because when we don't get clot cultures positive, we often used to also do a bone marrow culture. So there can be many other infectious etiologies implicated in acquired aplastic or even transient aplasia, like EB virus, hepatitis, HIV, so parvovirus, leptospirosis, dengue, cytomegalovirus. Very many other conditions can cause transient suppression of the marrow. So one must keep in mind when a patient comes with any infection that this could be sepsis-induced bone marrow suppression. Let's look at another patient. Apsana, a six-year-old female child, came with fever for 5 months, with lymphadenopathy for 2 months, bleeding gums 7 days, and epistaxis on the day of admission. Father had died of Cox 1 year ago. Child was on AKT for 4 months with no response. And on examination, vitals were stable. She had lymphadenopathy, both cervical and axillary, which was significant. And there was pallor, significant petechial rash, bleeding gums, liver and spleen, both 2 centimeters palpable, with respiratory system showing fine Krebs and other systems normal. The impression we made was because she was on TB treatment already, she could be MDR Cox with aplastic anemia or myelodysplasia, and to rule out HIV as a co-infection, and Alps syndrome because of the large lymph nodes. So when we investigated her, hemoglobin was 5.8, total count 2,200, platelets again 19,000, MCV 81, RDW was on the higher side, and there were good polymorphs and lymphocytes with eosinophils and monocytes also present. Now here it was a normocytic with a wide RDW, so there was a nutritional element probably in this patient. MPV was low, retic was low. So there was a marrow involvement also. And HIV was negative. Lymph node biopsy showed acid-fast bacilli present with MTB complex isolated. So once we had this, we did a bone marrow aspiration. It showed hypocellular marrow with megaloblastic changes in erythroid cells. It could be myelodysplastic changes, which look like megaloblastic changes. Megakaryocytes were reduced. Myeloid cells were showing increased granules with dysplasia. Now, all this will suggest that the marrow is not effective in throwing out mature cells into the periphery. And therefore, there was pancytopenia. And there was TB granuloma present on the bone marrow biopsy. And that, therefore, the diagnosis was MDR-COX-induced bone marrow suppression. And what happened further to her? We started her on 5-drug AKT, as was the protocol those days. Gave her iron folate. She improved significantly clinically in a month's time. Repeat CBC showed 8.8 gram hemoglobin, 6,700 white cells and 80,000 platelets, which was 19,000 that time. So she has gone up. RDW was still on the higher side. MCV had dropped a little. So we did a study also to look at whether HIV infected children also can develop pancytopenia due to either aplasia of the marrow or myelodysplasia of the marrow. This was done as a dissertation by my student Ramya. And what were the findings? In 73 cases out of 100 children who were HIV infected, she found some hematological manifestation. And pancytopenia was seen in 6 of them. So pancytopenia can happen with HIV too. Then there is also a report of a transient pancytopenia after non-A, non-B, non-C acute hepatitis preceding acute lymphoblastic leukemia. So there was a hepatitis, transient pancytopenia, and then the patient was diagnosed as B-cell ALL. Of course, parvovirus, we are aware, can cause pancytopenia, but it mostly causes anemia. So you can see in one study done by another student of mine, where we found out of the 17 patients that she reviewed, the commonest hematological manifestation was anemia, but pancytopenia was seen in 2 of the 17. That is 11%. So that is also known, and we have also seen it. Now let's look at this another case. A 3-year-old male child born of third degree consanguineous marriage came in September 2014 with chief complaints of fever for 1 week with history of recurrent respiratory infections in the past. pallor for 2 days, petechia over arms and legs for 2 days, ulcers in oral cavity for 1 day, admitted in private hospital for 6 days, treated with antibiotics and given platelets because there was petechia. Actually, you don't give platelets for petechia. His diet was mainly vegetarian. On examination, vitals were stable. Anthropometry was low, -2 to -3 standard deviation. And no icterus, cyanosis, clubbing, lymph nodes or bony tenderness. Petechia all over upper lower limbs. No retinal hemorrhages. Hyperpigmentation over knuckles and perioral region. And systemic examination, liver was palpable 2 centimeters, spleen not palpable, rest was normal. So we thought he's a PEM with megaloblastic anemia or a chronic liver disease or an HIV. But these were all not substantiated by the laboratory findings. None of these came out to be positive. His hemoglobin was 4.2 gram percent. His white cell counts were 4,000. His platelets were 4,000. It was normocytic, normochromic anemia. MCV was high, 103. So morphology on the smear was probably reported as normocytic, but it is actually macrocytic. So RDW was 65.5 by SD, so slightly elevated. ANC was low. So this was a marrow disease again. This was the marrow. It was absolutely empty marrow, aplastic anemia. And we did his chromosomal breakage, and it showed high frequency of chromosomal breakage with mitomycin C, suggestive of Fanconi anemia. So he was a Fanconi's anemia. Mind you, he didn't have any phenotypic manifestations except growth failure. But it was weight and height both compromised. If it was only height compromised, it is more evident. But both being compromised sometimes misleads us. Now, if you look at his ultrasound, his left kidney was not visualized in the renal fossa. It was in the pelvis. So he had a left-sided pelvic kidney, which is again known in Fanconi's. So genetic syndromes are plenty, and some of them have certain associated clinical features, but they may not always manifest in every person. Like in Fanconi's, you don't always see these changes of hyperpigmentation, perioral, abnormal thumb, radii, urinary malformations, urinary tract malformations, renal anomalies. You have dyskeratosis congenita, where also you can have nail lesions and reticulated pigmentation over the neck and back, and in Shwachman-Diamond pancreatic insufficiency. In amegakarocytic thrombocytopenia, there's hardly anything which you will see phenotypically. So specifically, various studies need to be done, and molecular. This is what we do nowadays, molecular study to diagnose these conditions. I think I had shown you all some of the amegakarocytic thrombocytopenia and Viscott-Aldrich in the bleeding patients. So nowadays we are doing, and therefore we are finding more patients with all these findings. Now if you look at all these children, they look similar. They all have microphthalmia, microcornea, pigmentation periorally, a funny triangular face with a sharp nose. You can see all of them. They are all Fanconi's, and he has a bifid thumb. If you see this, bifid thumb. All these are bifid thumbs. And renal anomalies, where you have a horseshoe-shaped kidney. Here it is a pelvic kidney, sorry. Here is a horseshoe-shaped kidney, you can see. And these are double ureters. So all the renal anomalies can be there in Fanconi's patients. And if we have time, I'll take one more case. Preeti?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, okay. So this was a 4-month-old male child, male infant, only child, non-consanguineous marriage, seen by pediatrician for cough, fever, breathlessness for 8 days. On evaluation, was found to have bicytopenia by the pediatrician, 7.2 gram hemoglobin and platelets 62,000, and a retic which was below 1%. And he was referred to our center in view of hepatosplenomegaly and thrombocytopenia. And this was all done in January 2018. And he was a well-nourished child. He was irritable when he came to us with mild tachypnea, tachycardia, pallor, knuckle hyperpigmentation, no petechia, ecchymosis, or any other bleeding. And liver 3 centimeters, spleen 6.5 centimeters, and systemically he was otherwise okay. So the provisional diagnosis that we made was acute leukemia to rule out storage disorder, osteopetrosis, and hemolytic anemias like thalassemia and congenital dyserythropoietic anemia. So when we looked at his CBC, his RBC count was on the lower side, 8.1 gram hemoglobin. His RDW was 18, MCV was 72, white cells were 5.66, that is 5,660, with lymphocytic predominance with 61% and monocytes 16%, platelets of 38,000. Cytic count was low, bone marrow was seen, and it was having hemophagocytosis. As you can see, this is a true picture from our microscope. This is taken by a camera and this is taken directly into the storage, the chip. So this was suggestive of HLH, but just finding hemophagocytes on marrow is not a criteria for HLH. So we did all the other workup, and ferritin was high, triglycerides were high, fibrinogen was low normal, and granule release assay was significantly low with CD107A expression of only 7%, which is significantly low. And once we diagnosed HLH, we sent for molecular studies, but while we were awaiting the report from molecular studies, we started him on HLH protocol with cyclosporine, etoposide, dexamethasone on 23rd Jan, IVIG given over 2 days, blood product support, antiviral, antifungal, antibacterial prophylaxis, and we did his EBV PCR, which was positive later, and then we gave him rituximab for EBV PCR also, 4 doses. And this was his molecular report. He was familial hemophagocytic lymphohistiocytosis 3. And this child was taken up for transplant. This is in the transplant unit. He did not have a sibling and his parents didn't match with him. So we took him up for a haploidentical transplant with father. That means half match only. And we gave conditioning with various drugs, GVHD prophylaxis with post-transplant cyclophosphamide, and infused him on. So nearly a year after he has come to us, because HLH has to be completely suppressed and we had to procure funds for him. So it took so much time, 1 year, and infused him in January 2019. 1 year post, immediate post-transplant CBC, you can see 8.8 gram hemoglobin, white cells 4,630 and platelets 262,000. You can see 1 year post-transplant, he's doing well, 9.3 gram hemoglobin with 7,910 white cells and 5,16,000 platelets. So he's really doing well. There's one more patient which I'll quickly take. A 3-year-old male child referred for pancytopenia, fever and weight loss for a month, severe pallor, pedal edema and SAM. Liver spleen was palpable. CBC showed pancytopenia with retic 4%, LDH high, MP negative, ferritin triglycerides were raised. Monospot test was positive for EBV. Those days we didn't have EBV PCR, so we used to do monospot test. This is from SIAN. Bone marrow showed hemophagocytosis, was treated with IVIG steroids and cyclosporine. He did well. And this was the finding on the marrow. So this was another HLH. So HLH can happen either as primary or secondary. Primary means the familial ones where you have the FHL1, which is unknown, and then 2, 3, 4, 5 are already defined, the gene defects. And you have the pigmentary dilutional syndromes, which is Shediak-Higashi, Hermansky-Pudlak, and Griscelli. And you have secondary HLH, where you have bacterial infections, viral infections, protozoal, parasitic, all these can cause. Also, you have the macrophage activation syndrome, which is known to be present in those with collagen vascular disorders or rheumatoid conditions, where you can get hypercytokinemia, which can respond to steroids alone. So confirming diagnosis by 2004 criteria, a molecular diagnosis is the most important. If you get that, you are done with the diagnosis. But if you don't have that, then you can take any 5 of the 8 criteria which are listed, which I will show you. Initial diagnostic criteria, clinical, fever, splenomegaly, laboratory, you have more than 2 cytopenias, hypertriglyceridemia and or hypofibrinogenemia, histopathologic evidence of hemophagocytosis, and high ferritins, low or absent NK cell activity, soluble CD25, which is high. So, and then there are corroborative evidences. If there's CNS involvement, liver involvement, you should look for that. MRI can be done or spinal fluid changes can be looked at. There are many other newer manifestations which have now been added. So in summary, the key messages in a pancytopenia, do not forget to look at clinical pointers. Is it an acute onset? Then it could be a transient viral suppression, megaloblastic anemia, etc. If it is insidious onset, it is more likely to be an aplastic anemia or a grave disease like myelodysplastic syndrome, or leukemias, etc. So age at presentation, if it's very early in life, think of the inherited disorders also. And very early in life, think of HLH. If they are a little older, 4 to 7 years, Fanconi's anemia can manifest at that age. Acquired aplastic generally you see in little older children. Differentiate between transient versus chronic. Manifestations of all three cell line depletion should be looked for. Lymphadenopathy, hepatosplenomegaly should also be looked for. Constitutional features of various inherited bone marrow failure syndromes should be looked for. And family history is very crucial, because if you have a family history, it is easy to consider an inherited disorder. So in short, when you are looking at pancytopenia, look at the clinical pointers and then you look at the investigations. In investigations, look at the red cell indices, blood smear, reticulocytes, indirect bilirubin. On clinical evaluation, if there is evidence of hemolysis and Coombs test is positive, then you think of various conditions like infections, autoimmune cytopenias, hypersplenism, if splenomegaly is present, if chronic hemolysis with hemoglobinuria, PNH should be considered. On smear, if you find blast, obviously do a bone marrow. You see a bone marrow replacement with blast with secondary malignancy or metastasis, then of course it's a malignancy. If you do not see blast, but you see hypoplasia, if it is mild, infections are common. There's significant bone marrow failure, then aplastic anemia. If there is fibrosis and or myelodysplasia, then think of myelodysplasia. And if you find macrocytosis, macroovulocytosis with hypersegmented polymorphs, which I showed you in one of the patients, Fanconi's and dyskeratosis congenita and megaloblastic anemia should be considered. So I think pancytopenia is not an easy task to manage, because it has so much varied etiologies and so many things to look at, that it's always safer if you're not able to make a diagnosis or suspect some particular diagnosis to refer to a hematologist for opinion, because then the hematologist will pin down the cause and treat the patient accordingly. Also, as I told you, in aplastic especially, do not delay, because referral for a transplant should be done before a lot of transfusions have been given, because outcomes get impacted by that. I think that's my last slide. Thank you very much for a patient hearing.
Thank you very much, madam. Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I would like to ask, in case of a megaloblastic anemia, if the platelet count is very low, that is 15,000 or 20,000, then intramuscular B12 will be, we can't give intramuscular. So can we give IV preparation?
Yes, yes. So in case of very severe thrombocytopenia, is highly uncommon in megaloblastic, but sometimes it can be there, as you rightly pointed out. So you can use intravenous B12, no problem at all. And or you can use even sublingual, but sublingual sometimes may not work as well. So you are right, you can use intravenous. Any other questions?
And, ma'am, can spontaneous recovery occur in aplastic anemia?
So yes, sometimes it can happen, but again, if it is an milder to moderate, then sometimes it happens. Mm-hmm. By and large, severe, I have not seen spontaneously recovering.
So considering bone marrow transplantation, ma'am,
yeah.
So if the mild or moderate aplastic anemia,
we don't transplant. The indication for transplant is severe to very severe aplastic anemia.
Okay.
That's the reason we don't consider transplant for mild to moderate, because they might self-remit. They could be transient. They could be just because of some infection. So someone has asked, can malaria present? Yes, malaria can have secondary HLH. Dengue can have secondary HLH. We have seen patients. Malaria, I've seen about a series of 5 patients I had presented in one conference, but we have seen many more. But when it is malaria induced or dengue induced, just giving some steroid and IVIG works. You don't have to give cyclosporine, etoposide or the whole protocol, because it's not really that difficult to treat the condition. Dengue is self-limiting virus, and malaria, you have anti-malarials. So once you give anti-malarials, by and large, these patients become fine. You don't even need much of steroid. IVIG alone is good enough.
Madam, from your experience over the years, do you think this HLH incidence is increasing, or we were missing the diagnosis previously?
So we were not aware of it probably, and we were considering those patients as sepsis-induced bone marrow suppression, or you know, peripheral cytopenias, and treating them with only antibiotics and supportive care. So probably now we are wiser, and therefore we are diagnosing HLH. Earlier we were not diagnosing.
And overall, in secondary HLH, what is your outcome?
Secondary HLH outcomes are better than primary, unless you transplant. Because primary, there is no other option. You have to transplant. But in secondary, if you treat the etiology, then they come around, by and large. But now we are of the opinion whether this is really secondary or it is triggered by an infection. And there is some background familial problem in this patient. So
people working in our area, we are we have resources limitation. So but this genetic testing and all these things, we cannot work up here. Either we have to label it as a secondary or we have to treat it, whatever it is.
So, you know, if you are talking of molecular test, it costs 19,000. So one time 19,000 to mobilize may not be very difficult for any family if you explain to them why they should do it. And if they can't, then please refer them to us. We will mobilize through donors and we will do it for them. So we are actually managing patients. Even transplant in this patient, we have done at free of cost. The parent did not pay anything. So we are a municipal hospital who is doing transplants, and we are managing these patients without charging them. Of course, for tests, sometimes we make them pay, because unless they are designated for transplant, donors don't support. So sometimes they have to pay for the initial testing, but that much they don't mind when we tell them that your 12-leg transplant is going to be done free of cost.
Yeah, great, great, madam. One more query related. Actually, it may be a question for nephrologist. This leukemia lymphoma, how much is the incidence of nephrotic syndrome related to
this? It is not very high. For example, whatever I have seen in my career, all leukemics, if I were to say about, say, 1,500 leukemics or 2,000 leukemics that I have handled, out of them, I remember only two who have had nephrotic. So it's not very common to have full-fledged nephrotic. But suppose, you know, a patient of leukemia dies and you were to do an autopsy, histopathology of the kidneys, if they are still having the disease ongoing, they will definitely have blast infiltration in the kidneys, because it infiltrates through blood into every organ.
But they present with typical nephrotic syndrome or hematuria and all this?
No, so those two which I'm talking of both presented with typical nephrotic only. And incidentally on...
Immune-mediated or because... may be the...
When it is not immune-mediated, it is infiltrative. It is damage to the glomeruli through the infiltration.
Hematuria we expect.
So with glomeruli involved, you may get hematuria, but we had not seen in these two. There was albuminuria anasarca. Yeah.
And those cases were steroid sensitive.
Yes, both of these were steroid sensitive.
That's why biopsy was not done and diagnosis was
taken. Yes. And CBC has to be looked at. I think CBC should be done for every patient who comes to a clinic where you are going to give some major treatment. You must do a CBC and evaluate the CBC properly. Then once you evaluate CBC properly, you will not miss. It's very simple.
Probably we have to stress on your first lecture only. ABC of CBC.
We can do it second time again for newer people if they are interested. We'll do it once again. Because you saw in this patient.
Yeah.
That if you had evaluated the CBC first time, you wouldn't have missed the condition of pancytopenia.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
anyway.
I think after your lecture, ma'am, everyone will see total count, platelet count, RDW, along with the HB. I think this will be done by everyone now.
Hope so.
And it will be useful to us.
Yeah. No, no, that's why that case I always show in my presentation, because that is an eye-opener. Even when we saw it and I told my juniors, look at the CBC and this patient's diagnosis was made as iron deficiency. Are you convinced? Like, yeah, yeah, madam. Without looking at MCV, 91 MCV, you can't call it a low MCV by any standard. You may call it normal in USA because they take up to 95 normal. We don't take even up to 95. We take up to 90 as normal, 80 to 90. So anything that is supposed to be microcytic should be below 80. At least below 80. And in iron deficiency, you will see 60, 55, not 91. So it was very sad that it was missed like that. But I can imagine, you know, if I see a nephrological problem in my clinic, I may not make out what a nephrologist will make out. So I suppose we have to allow that leeway for our colleagues also who are specialists in other fields. You know, we can't be sort of critical of it, but it's a good learning for us that don't miss these points.
Yeah. Again, there is persistent demand that your first lecture should be repeated. Okay. Instead of recorded version, I think you can reformat and present your next question.
Okay, we can do case-based CBC evaluation.
Yes.
That
should
be far better.
Yeah, yeah. Instead of theoretically discussing CBC, we'll put cases with CBC and then discuss it out.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll do that. Yeah.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Sure.
Thank you.
Very, very enthusiastically your lectures, and really they are finding us very useful and worth keeping them in our files.
Thank you so much. Thank you.